Hello, welcome to another episode of Thick Slices and Deep Cuts. On today's episode, I will be discussing and ranking the studio discography of legendary American prog rockers, Kansas. In my estimation, really, they are the only classic prog band to be from the States. And when I say classic prog band, I just mean one of the bands that was back in the 70s, back in that timeless, that day of classic prog. You know, Rush is close, but they're in Toronto. That's Canada. You know, Frank Zappa, you could make an argument for. He's certainly truly progressive in the, you know, in the truest sense of the word. So you did have Frank Zappa, but when you're talking about a band that kind of plays in that same style as, like, Yes, but certainly brings their own, their own thing to the table, especially with the violin, things like that. But in classic, you know, prog rock form, they were really the only American band, or at least the only legit, you know, Hall of Fame, all-star type progressive rock band. So they have 15 studio albums. I think Prog Archives has one of their albums listed as a proper album, but I'm not going to include it. It's called Always Never the Same, and it's them re-recording classic songs with, like, an orchestra and then doing a cover of a Beatles song. To me, it's more of a glorified greatest hits, so I'm not going to be ranking Always Never the Same. So with that said, I'm going to be ranking 15 studio albums. I own 13 of the 15, so I'm pretty happy with that, but I don't have all of them. There are two that I am missing. Let's see. Real quick, I always talk about eras and phases. I'm just going to say this with Kansas. They have, let's just break it into three simple eras. They had six albums they put out in the 70s, they had five albums that they put out in the 80s, and they've had four albums that they put out since. One in the 90s, one in the 2000s, one in the 2010s, and one here in the 2020s. So I'm just going to break it into three basic eras like that. But it doesn't mean they didn't have some phases within those eras, like a specific lineup maybe for a couple albums, or a different singer, or a different guitar player, or a reunion, or something like that. So, But I guess we'll just get right into it. Also, the top seven albums I rank are all just, in my estimation, just classics. Go get them. They're all awesome. That's the top seven. The bottom three were pretty much my bottom three. The bottom three were the bottom three. And then the middle five, 12, 11, 10, 9, 8, right in there, that was the toughest to rank. Because all of those albums I like, they're all maybe a little flawed, or there's some maybe issue with them, but I do like them all. They do have good qualities to them. So 12 through 8 was really tough to figure out, but the bottom three I pretty much knew, and I knew my top seven. Okay, so with that said, let's get into it. We got 15 of these, so I'll try and get moving here. So coming in at number 15, I am going to go with 1986's Power. I hope this is high enough up in the ads. So this is an album that came out in 86. It features Steve Morse on guitars from the Dixie Drugs and then later on to B&B Purple. Steve Morse is your guitar player. Also, this is the first one with Billy Greer on bass. He's still in the band to this day. You still have Phil Ehart and Rich Williams, two original members. And Steve Walsh comes back. He had left the band for the previous two albums. He was gone for at least 5 years or so. But he's back. He doesn't sound like the classic Steve Walsh from the first his first tenure with the band. It seems like his voice has changed. And this album is my least favorite because it is just so cheesy 80s sounding. It's from 86. They sound like Survivor, the band Survivor. He sounds like Survivor. They're doing All I Wanted, which is just a sappy 80s ballad. It sounds like music for Top Gun. I mean, you know, you've got Steve Morse here, but he's just sort of underutilized. It's nice that he knows how to play his guitar, but his guitar playing is not up in the mix necessarily, and it's certainly not going to save these songs. I mean, this is just going for radio hits. Total commercial. Silhouettes in Disguise, I don't know. Might be about the best thing on here, but I don't even care for it. Secret Service is hilarious. The title track, Power, is painful. That chorus is painful. There's an instrumental called Musicado. I expect more out of an instrumental from these guys. It's kind of tame, and it goes into Taking in the View, which is probably it stands the test of time, probably the best of anything on here. So I would say Musicado into Taking in the View is probably going to be your highlight on here. like I said, the side one is just full of cheesiness, and I just, I don't know. I think this gets a pretty low rating by the a lot of the fans. I guess, I'm sure there are people out there that like this style. I cringe when I hear this. This was the album I could find the least redeemable. In fact, there's really nothing I like on this album. So at number 15, I'm going with 1986's Power. And so then coming in at number 14, this is the consensus pick as the worst album, but I'm putting it at the second to last. And that's from 1983. I have Drastic Measures. So this album is 1983. This is the second album they did with John Elefante as their singer. He sounds kind of like Steve Walsh, but he's like almost like Steve Perry. A little bit more of a Journey type sound or a Foreigner sound. That cover's ridiculous. The only reason I picked this one over Power is the song Fight Fire with Fire, I do like. It's pretty catchy. There are little clips of moments of decent stuff, like on Mainstream or End of the Age. What's another one on here? Going Through the Motions is kind of, I mean, these are all cheesy, but there's little moments here. End of the Age is okay. You know, Everybody's My Friend is atrocious. Andy is atrocious. Get Rich is really silly. It's just a matter of which cheesy 80s you prefer over the other. The cheesy 1983 Journey Foreigner Loverboy sound, or this cheesy Survivor Top Gun sappy ballad sound. And I'm going to lean with this just barely over that. Plus, I like John Elefante's voice. I mean, I know he's not Steve Walsh, and Steve Walsh is is the singer for this band. But I think John Elefante is probably a better singer. And so that's probably another reason why I picked this one just slightly over Power. Because at least there are a few redeemable things on here, whereas with Power, I can't really find anything. Also, this is the first album without Robbie Steinhardt. So he's gone at this point. You know, I guess he left or was... They basically phased him... I feel like, I don't know this, I feel like he just kind of got phased out of the band. They were like, well, we got a new singer, and he's a good singer, and he's going to sing, so you don't have to sing. And we're in the 80s now, and we don't really need your violin. So Robbie Steinhardt was just, if he quit, he probably quit because they just didn't really have a need for him at this point, at this stage of the game. This is also so Robbie Steinhardt's gone. This is also the last album to feature Kerry Livgren for some time. So he stepped away as well here. Who else? I think that was... I'm trying to think. Steve Walsh is already gone at this point, so... Yeah, you still have Phil Ehart and Rich Williams, who are on every album. John Elefante... Oh, Dave Holt, the bass player, the original bass player. This is his last album with the band as well. So there you go, at number 14... Usually considered their worst album by the fans. I'm going with 1983's Drastic Measures. At number 13, this is one of the two I don't own, but at number 13, I'm going to go with 1988's In the Spirit of Things. So this is the second and final album with Steve Morse in the band. So that little phase of Steve Morse started with Power, goes through In the Spirit of Things. Steve Walsh is back, but again, Steve Walsh just doesn't sound like the Steve Walsh we remember. And Bob Ezrin they bring in to produce, and so this is a concept album, apparently about a town that got flooded out in Kansas. And while that may be interesting, this album to me is boring. Like, I'm bored. It reminds me, and it's funny because Bob Ezrin, I believe, was the producer not only for Pink Floyd's The Wall, but like The Final Cut is more what I'm thinking here. And while The Wall has its moments, it also has some boring downtime, and The Final Cut has tons of downtime. And I feel like In the Spirit of Things is just like the opening track Ghosts, I'm bored. It's four and a half minutes, and I'm bored. And I forget, One Big Sky, they have everybody singing the chorus together, kind of like Another Brick in the Wall, where you got We Don't Need No Education. They got like 50 people singing the chorus, but I don't care for that melody. Inside of Me is another one that I think was supposed to be one of the top tracks on here, but it's just kind of annoying. And then it goes into like ballads and slow mellow stuff, and it's just not very exciting. The highlight of this album, though, it does have redeeming qualities. The Preacher is an excellent song, but it's buried back towards the back of the album. But The Preacher is the one song on here where I played it the first time I heard it, I immediately played it again. It's one of those tracks you like so much you probably play it three times in a row. It definitely stands out as the highlight here. And then the track after that, Rainmaker, is the longest song, I believe. There's a lot going on with that track, so it's kind of proggy in that sense, where it goes all over the place. And again, I don't know the ins and outs of the storyline, but it seems like there is a lot going on in terms of the storyline during that song, Rainmaker. So I would say the highlights are tracks 9 and 10. You got 12 tracks on this album, and 9 and 10 are your highlights. So there's a good strong 11 minutes towards the end of the album. That's why it's kind of getting the nod over these two 80s cheesy albums. This one has a few things that are redeemable on it. I think In the Spirit of Things is not nearly as obviously cheesy, even though it's from 88 and it sounds like it's from the 80s. It's a little less on the cheese, and it's more boring than anything, but when it's good, it's good. It's got about 11 minutes of excellent music towards the back half of the album. So it's coming in at number 13 I've got from 88, In the Spirit of Things. This is the last album to feature Steve Morris, and it's the last album they did for several years. But there you go. That's coming in at number 13. Okay, coming in at number 12. So this is that middle, 12 through 8. All of these albums have flaws, but I like them. And so here we go. Coming in at number 12 from 1980, I have Audio Visions. Strange cover. I don't know if I like it or not. I think I like it. It's very strange. So this is the seventh and final album with the classic original lineup. Sort of. Technically, we'll get to another thing later. But, after this album, Steve Walsh leaves. This is 80. So it had already started, but they're into 1980. You're no longer in the 70s. And they're on a major label. They're pumping out albums every year. They're a prog band, but they're trying to write hits. And it's 1980. So this is just you've got some awkward moments on here. It starts out Relentless is okay. It's all right. Anything for You, I don't care for. Hold On is a ballady hit that it's actually works. That one, even though it's kind of not my cup of tea, I think it kind of works. Loner and Curtain of Iron is the deep track on here. That song's awesome. That's a song that they should bring back if they're ever going to revisit this and do some deep cuts for the fans. Play Curtain of Iron. That song is great. Very progressive. And that ends side one. Got to Rock On, start side two. That's kind of a catchy one. I mean, they try to write as many pop, poppier hits, and some of them work. I mean, they're not great, but they're all right. Got to Rock On's okay. Don't Open Your Eyes. I don't know. No One Together is okay. I mean, it's not a perfect song, but it certainly has some passages within it. I think it's the longest song on the album. And then No Room for a Stranger and Backdoor. It kind of finishes a little weak. So I would say this is not a perfect album. There are a lot of tracks on here that I can. There are a few that I would skip, and there are a few that have nice moments, and there are things on here that are pretty painfully cheesy and haven't stood the test of time well. But that said, it's 1980. This is their seventh album in 6 years or 7 years. And it does have Curtain of Iron, which is great. It does have No One Together, which is pretty good. I think Relentless is all right. I think Hold On is worthy of and Got the Rock On, those are okay for what they're trying to be. So this is coming in at number 12, but I would say that there's a vast jump in quality or in enjoyment from those bottom three to number 12. So there you go. At number 12, their seventh album, the final one with that classic lineup for some time. From 1980, I have Audio Visions. Okay. Coming in at number 11, and I mean, my 10 and 11 just kept flipping back and forth. They're basically tied. But coming in at number 11, this is the only other one I don't have a physical copy of. But at number 11, I'm going to go with, from 1995, I'm going with Freaks of Nature. Freaks of Nature was the first album in 7 years. Steve Walsh is still there on vocals. They're just down to one guitar player, so it's just Rich Williams. They brought in David Ragsdale on violin and other guitars, and this is the first time you've really seen violin for a while. So Drastic Measures, Power, and In the Spirit of Things didn't have a violin player on them. I mean, there may have been violins technically somewhere in there, but they didn't have a violin player. So Freaks of Nature is a nice return to form. It comes out in 95. Love that riff. It's good in that they're trying to get back to more of that timeless sound of the 70s. You know, you're no longer in the 80s, so you're not time-stamped into the 80s. So you're in the 90s. It's got a heavier production, kind of a raw production. The guitars are pretty heavy on it. And I do somewhat like the album. I think the songwriting at times is good. I think overall it's a good return to form, and you feel good about the direction of the band from the album Freaks of Nature. And you love the fact that David Ragsdale comes in on violin and is very prominent. We miss the violin, and David Ragsdale's a hell of a violin player. So I like his contribution. I think Steve Walsh's vocals here, and this is no secret, but he sounds, this might be one of his, you know, this is not a good vocal performance by him. Black Fathom 4, that's a deep cut they should play live. Black Fathom 4 is my favorite song on here. Desperate Times is pretty good. The title track, Freaks of Nature, is good. You know, the first track, I Can Fly, I think it's an okay track, but the way it opens up, Steve Walsh's voice is so terrible that it already has me cringing on the first moments of the album. But once I get used to it, I guess I'm okay with it. You know, other songs, Under the Knife is okay. Cold Gray Morning, Kerry Lipgren apparently wrote that and just gave it to the band. I don't think it's anything special. It's not bad. So I think this is an album that has some good songs on it for sure. And it has, I like the direction. I like bringing in David Ragsdale on violin. You know, it's 1995, so we don't have to deal with the pressure of writing 80s hits. I like that the guitars are heavy, but I don't think the production is necessarily one of their better productions. And I just think some of the tracks are not of the best caliber, but I do feel promise for this band moving forward at this point. So there you go. Coming in at number 11 from 1995, I'm going with Freaks of Nature. Okay, so at number 10, this is the album that was kind of tied with that. I could not figure out which one to put where. So at number 10, I'm going with, from 1979, I'm going with Monolith. Kind of cool artwork, also kind of dark, like literally kind of dark. It's hard to see everything. Crazy gatefold. So this is their sixth album, and this is coming off some big time success. Some big time success, and here we are in 79 with that classic lineup. And they put out 8 songs, and this is like, for me, this is like a purgatory album. Here's what I mean by that. Nothing's super progressive, but there aren't really any hits on here for the radio. But it's not bad, but it's not overly good, but it's okay. It's just, you know, like, On the Other Side is okay. It's not bad. I wouldn't say it's a classic. Like, if you tried to find a song on here for a greatest hits comp, it would be difficult. I think People of the South Wind is your best chance, but even that comes in with like this corny keyboard sound. Angels Have Fallen, I think, is really good. How My Soul Cries Out for You is a strange one. That's probably the most experimental one on here. A Glimpse of Home is pretty good. And it ends with Reason to Be, which I think is pretty good too. Away From You and Stay Out of Trouble, eh. But for the most part, it's okay. They produced this themselves, and I think that may have been a mistake in hindsight. And here's why. I get that they wanted to control what they wrote, but they could have brought in like a co-producer who knew his job was basically just to help them with their ideas. Maybe make the sound brighter, because the sound on here is kind of dull. And an outside producer could have just said, hey, let's do another take. Hey, let's brighten up the guitars. Hey, let's brighten up the sounds you guys have. Or, hey, let's do something to make these songs pop a little bit more than they do. So I think they probably should have gotten like an outside co-producer, just somebody to help them make this not quite so dark and dull. And, you know, and if they had an outside producer, maybe they could have coaxed a bigger hit out of People of the South Wind or Reason to Be. And I think Angels Have Fallen has the most potential to be a classic, like, proggy one. And again, an outside producer could have maybe helped him just get that, these songs just a little bit more. I'm not saying this would have made this a classic, but it would have made it certainly better than, you know, 10th or 11th best Kansas album. But so this is just a tough one. I listened to this a lot for many years, and I keep thinking if I revisit it, my opinion of it will change. And my opinion has always been the same. It's just like, it's not bad. It's not great. It's not bad. It's not that catchy. It's not that proggy, but it is kind of proggy. So there you go. Kind of a frustrating album. But there you go. At number 10 from 1979, I have Monolith. Oh, and by the way, People of the South Wind is apparently the word Kansas translated as People of the South Wind. So there you go. Number 10, Monolith. Okay. Coming in at number 9. This was the reunion album from 2000. I have Somewhere to Elsewhere. So this is the return to form we were looking for on Freaks of Nature. Well, in 2000 it happens, and I think it happens mainly because they bring back the original lineup. So Dave Hope comes back on bass. Kerry Livgren wrote the whole album, apparently, and he comes back, obviously, on guitar. Robbie Steinhardt comes back on violin and, you know, secondary vocals. You still have Steve Walsh, Phil Ehart, and Rich Williams. You know, you have Billy Greer on bass still, so you have the original six, but you have seven, so you have still Billy Greer on bass. And so you have this reunion, and Icarus 2, the first track, is classic. That is a great track. Probably the best thing on here. You know, Myriad is another good, like, long, proggy one. Distant Vision is another nice, long, proggy one. Then you got shorter ones that are cool, like Byzantium. I think that's excellent. It's an excellent proggy, moody, 4.5-minute piece. Look at the Time. It's got a nice little, like, Beatlesque melody. Then they got some bluesy stuff I'm not too crazy about, but I think Grand Fun Alley is okay. Catchy, at least. Not Man Big is kind of cool. It's, you know, it's kind of bluesy and goofy, but I kind of like it. It kind of works. So I find that, you know, this is the last one with Steve Walsh. His voice is sounding kind of rough at this point, but that cover's great, and I find myself digging a lot of these tracks. And I think this is, you know, I think as they've come back to form in this later era, which is, you know, the 90s to the present, I think Freaks of Nature was a good return to form. It just, you know, the songwriting and the production wasn't quite there, and the vocal quality wasn't quite there, but I liked where they were headed. And here it sounds good. It sounds like they're getting even closer to what a lot of people want Kansas to be, which is just a prog band. They can write catchy tunes, but give us those adventurous epics. And I think this has enough of that on there. So there you go. Coming in at number 9, just a very solid album from 2000, the reunion album. That's another thing. David Ragsdale was, you know, not in the band for some period of time because Robbie Steinhardt had come back. So no David Ragsdale here, but we'll hear about him here momentarily. So there you go. Number 9 from 2000, Somewhere to Elsewhere. Okay, here's sort of my surprise pick. I think this is considered one of their... The fans consider this one of their least favorite albums, and it's right in the middle. 8 is literally in the middle of these 15 albums. I don't know what to say. I listen to it. I like it. That's the bottom line, is I like it a lot. So at number 8, I'm going with, from 1982, Vinyl Confessions. Is that Neil Sean? No, that's John Elefante. So Steve Walsh is gone. They bring in John Elefante, and I got to speed things up here, but... Put out a heck of an album. All these tracks are great. Play the Game Tonight was their third biggest hit behind Dust in the Wind and Carry On Wayward Son. Right Away is good. Chasing Shadows is the song they should sing to this day. That's really cool. No drums or anything. Diamonds and Pearls, it's them doing Steely Dan. Face It's good. Crossfire at the End is the where they saved the kind of the prog year bits. It's a 6.5-minute song with some breakdowns. So this album is usually ridiculed by the fans, but I really dig it. This is the last one with Robbie Steinhardt, though, because, you know, he's not singing much, and his violin is almost at a minimum. So this is them kind of phasing him out. Maybe not intentionally, but you're well into the 80s here, and they don't have a need for violin and secondary vocalists. So I'll speed it up, but I just have to say this was the big surprise for me in doing this ranking was Vinyl Confessions. from 82, coming in at number 8 for me. Okay, so as I said, the top 7 were all classics. Here we go. And I got to speed this up. It's unfortunate. But at number 7, this was kind of tough, but I'm going with Mask from 75. This is their third album. I think that when I'm picking some of these albums and why this one's 7th and not maybe 3rd or 4th, I think it's got, like, It Takes a Woman's Love, 2 Cents Worth. It's got some shorter songs to start it that I'm not crazy about. But Icarus is great. All the World's pretty good. Child of Innocence is a ripper. It's You is great for being 2.5 minutes. Mysteries of Mayhem is all right. The other big epic, the big epic on here is The Pinnacle. So The Pinnacle is probably my favorite thing. Well, Icarus is probably my favorite thing. And then The Pinnacle is your big epic. So this is classic. Of their first 5 albums, this is the first one I'm ranking at number 7. Their first 5 albums are great. This is probably my least favorite of the first 5, but not because it's bad. I think the other ones are just so damn good. And this has a few short songs that I'm not crazy about, but I understand they're trying to give the record label and the radio station hits while they also do their prog epic thing. So I'm okay with them trying it. But there you go. Number 7 from 75, their third album, Mask. All right, at number 6, now we're moving all the way up to 2016 with The Prelude Implicit. Love what they're doing these days. Ronnie Platt in on vocals. He sounds incredible. You got Zach Risby writing a lot of this stuff and producing. Visibility Zero, Rhythm in the Spirit. Refugee's awesome. The Voyage of 818, Camouflage, Summer, Crowded Isolation. This album is pretty much awesome from start to finish. The productions are great. Kansas is completely gone back to the spirit of what we loved about the first 5 albums. That 74 to 77 run is totally back in play here. Everything's just very progressive and smooth and catchy and all those things. And tons of violin. David Ragsdale is back. So this is great. I would go on more about it, but The Prelude Implicit is my number 6. I really dig it a lot. I dig what they're doing right now. In fact, it's no secret, my top 7 comprise of the first 5 albums and the most recent stuff they're doing with Ronnie Platt. So there you go. Number 6, The Prelude Implicit from 2016. All right, number 5. Going with their debut from 74, recorded in 73. What can I say? It's awesome. You've got Can I Tell You comes out ripping. Biloxi's is good, but short, but it's proggy. Then you've got Journey from Mary Abron's, the best thing on here. It also has a song, A Pirque, which is a long, epic one. And then it ends with Death of Mother Nature Suite, which is heavy and awesome. So this one has like 3 epics. And then it's got 2 rockers early on with Can I Tell You and Biloxi's. And then you get the 3 epics, Journey from Mary Abron, A Pirque, and Death of Mother Nature Suite. So this debut is killer. And it's my number 5. You'd think it would be higher than that. But when you get an album like number 4's Point of No Return, it's tough to put that any higher. What can I say about Point of No Return? It's probably their biggest or second biggest album. The title track, Paradox. The Spider we heard earlier is crazy technical. Portrait, He Knew. Dust in the Wind, what more do I need to say about that? My favorite track on here probably is Hopelessly Human. I really dig that one. Probably their best artwork, so that's incredible. I mean, they play the thing live in its entirety. It's great. There you go. All right, number 3, maybe a shocker. I love their latest album from 2020, The Absence of Presence. Not only is this that lineup with Ronnie Platt and David Ragsdale and Zach Risby's on guitars, but now you bring in Tom Brislin, keyboard player for formerly of Yes, and Camel and everyone else. And the songs on here are incredible. This is one of my favorite albums of 2020. I hope they play a ton of this live. The title track, Throwing Mountains, Jets Overhead, Circus of Illusion, Memories Down the Line, Never. Just incredible. Incredible. That's my number 3. And Kansas has incredible albums, and this is all the way at 3. So 2 left. So at number 2, I'm going with their second album from 75, Song for America. Why do I dig this one so much? Well, I love the song Song for America. It's probably my second favorite song they ever did. We're listening to Incommudro, Hymn to the Atman. It's their deepest track, the most overlooked track they need to play live. I love it. With all this Zelda Nintendo music going on. Lamplight Symphony. So you only have 6 songs. 3 of them are awesome, cool, proggy epics. 3 of the 6. And I'm not usually a big bluesy guy, but Lonely Street is just dirty and bluesy with an odd time signature, so I love that too. So this album just kills. It has their longest songs. It's probably their most self-indulgent album, but it's so progged out. like I said, Song for America and Comedro and Lamplight Symphony. There you go, number two from 75, their second album, Song for America. And so, no shocker here at number one, their fourth album from 76, Left Overture. Magnum Opus, we heard earlier, my favorite song they ever did. The Wall, you know, it's got Carry On Wayward Son. What's On My Mind, Miracles Out of Nowhere, Opus Insert, Cheyenne Anthem. It's just the perfect album. It's a perfect album. It's got epics, but they've also become better songwriters, and they kind of get the epics in like 6 minutes on this album. So there you go. I'll do this real quick. At 15, you've got Power at 14, Drastic Measures at 13, In the Spirit of Things at 12, you have Audio Visions at 11, Freaks of Nature at 10, Monolith at 9, Somewhere to Elsewhere at 8, Vinyl Confessions at 7, I've got Mask at 6, I've got The Prelude Implicit at 5, I have the self-titled debut. At 4, I have Point of No Return. At 3, I have The Absence of Presence. At 2, Song for America. And at number 1, Left Overture. Also, we heard some of the versions of those songs from the classic 2 for the Show from 78, one of the great live albums. But I would recommend also getting it on CD because you get a ton of extra tracks. Basically, you get CD 1 on vinyl, but if you get it on CD, CD 2 is all additional tracks. So I would definitely get it there. Also, The Best of Kansas from 84. I have the newer version, but I need to find the original vinyl because there's a song that John Elefante did with them called Perfect Lover, which actually I think sounds all right. And when they reissued this, they took that off there. But The Best of Kansas is one of their biggest selling albums, actually. Their Greatest Hits was one of their big sellers. Let's see. Live and Beyond the Left Overture and Live and Beyond the Point of No Return CDs are great. If you go back earlier, Device Voice Drum was a cool live album. There's No Place Like Home was good. And as far as the Greatest Hits box set, I would maybe look at Sail On 30th Anniversary. It's heavy on the first five albums. Shocking. But it gives you like one track from everything else up to 2000. And then what else? I think that's pretty much it. I have all that stuff on vinyl I had on CD for a while. So I got this 3-pack, which has the first album, Kansas, it has Mask, and it has Monolith. So that was kind of cool. Obviously, Song for America, Point of No Return, Left Overture. These three were all remastered. I don't believe these three were remastered, because I don't think these were quite as popular. I think that covers it. So thank you for watching, and I will see you next time.